Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we bless your name for our service today. Thank you because we know that your word brings light and strength and power and stability to every life. And as we come here today, we pray, Lord, that you'll teach us your word and lead us into the truth by your Spirit in Jesus' name. And we're asking, O Lord, that your word will do good in every life, that your word will strengthen every one of us in Jesus' name, that in times of trials, in times of trouble, in times of temptation, in times of difficulty, tough times, difficult times, you will strengthen us for the battle and the conflict of the day in Jesus' name. That, Lord, as we have been saved and we have come into the kingdom and we're looking up to you, we'll not fall, we'll not go back, we'll not become like Judas Iscariot, like Demas who went back to the world and they lost their souls. But we'll be people that look up unto Jesus all the time, strengthened by his grace, energized by spirit, so that, Lord, on that final day when Christ shall come, will reign with the Lord in Jesus' name. Be with us today and help us to receive your word with readiness of mind, so that the strength and the power, the nourishment and the grace through your word will come into our lives in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I'm looking at Mark chapter 1 verse 13. Mark chapter 1 verse 13. We're looking at the victory of the Lord Jesus Christ over temptation. Mark has just a single verse for this experience of the Lord Jesus Christ in Mark chapter 1 verse 13. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days. Tempted of Satan, I was with the wild beasts, and angels ministered unto him. What Mark has recorded in one single verse, both Matthew and Luke record extensively. And as you turn to the account in Matthew, you see the details of what actually had happened in the previous verse, that is at the end of chapter 3. The Father in heaven had given recognition to the Lord Jesus Christ. And that didn't go down well with Satan the devil. As we look at chapter 3 of Matthew verse 17, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. As the Heavenly Father looked at the plan of salvation, and the Heavenly Father looked at the willingness of the Lord Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, to come into this world and save us from sin. And then every step he took, he did everything to fulfill all righteousness. The Father was so pleased and happy in heaven, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, say to the hearing of everyone, this is my beloved Son, in him I am well pleased. And then he was led, we're told in chapter 4 verse 1. Then was Jesus led of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. To start with, you understand, because Jesus Christ was tempted, the Holy Son of God, the sinless Son of God, and the spotless Son of God, because he was tempted, that tells us then, if the devil will not even spare the Lord Jesus Christ, but he will subject him to temptation, today too, temptation will come to every believer, to every follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, even when the Lord is saying, is well pleased with you, and the Spirit of God is bearing witness with your salvation, you are born again. And you are walking right, and you are living right, and there is no blemish, and there is no spot, there is no sin to your account in your life. Even then, don't think the devil will not come to tempt you, because here the Lord Jesus Christ went through the temptation. And then we see the details of the temptation as we look at it in verse 2, when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if not be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. You are hungry, aren't you? You see, it is the point of your need and your desire and your passion and what you are passionately looking for that the devil will bring temptation through that place. It says, because he was hungry. Then the devil came and he said, are you the Son of God? Did I hear the Heavenly Father say, this is my beloved Son? Oh, you see, the beloved Son of the Lord, the beloved Son of Jehovah, the beloved Son of God is hungry now. Well, if you are the Son of God, you have the same power that Almighty God has, since you have the nature of God. Why don't you turn these stones to be made bread? But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Well, the word of God, reaching word of God, the Lord Jesus Christ overcame the devil. He defeated the devil. He said, yes, you are telling me to turn stones to bread. You are telling me to perform a miracle. Here is where many people miss it. And they want to perform a miracle to show the devil their power. You miss it. They want to perform miracle to satisfy the curiosity of men and women. You miss it. You want to show a miracle to prove a point. To prove, yes, I still have the power. Yes, I still have the authority. Yes, I still can do whatever I want to do. And yet, you know, we children of God too, sometimes, you want to motivate and you want to push and you want to say, well, this is an evangelist. Well, here he has a great power of God. And you come looking for miracle. My dear friend, if you don't come with the right attitude, if you don't come with the right motive, if you don't come with the right intention, and you are telling the man of God, you are telling the preacher, you are telling the pastor, you are telling an evangelist, work a miracle and let us see. That pastor will be foolish to pray at that time, and that evangelist will be foolish and wise to pray at that time, and that man of God will be yielding to the devil to pray at that time. Members of the prayer warrior, do you understand? It is not everybody that comes running, walk a miracle, give me a miracle, show me a miracle, give me a healing. I need this, that you respond. Because you see, the devil may walk through them and he's saying, show something, demonstrate something. And you need to understand when to respond, when to react, when to do and when not to do. And so you see here, as the Lord Jesus Christ listened to the devil, and the devil said, if you be, as Jehovah God in heaven has said, as the Almighty God has even said publicly and pointedly, you are my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Well, if that is true, and you're hungry, and you need to satisfy that hunger, why don't you turn the stone to become bread? Thank God for Jesus Christ. I said, thank God for Jesus Christ. You know, if you only know a part of the word of God, and you do not know the totality and the fullness of the word of God, you're going to go astray. If you only know the word of God, relating to the possibility of faith, and the power of faith, and what you can do by faith, you can command and then stones to become bread. If that's the only thing you know, you will go astray and you will yield to the temptation of the devil. But thank God, Jesus knew the totality of the word. So Jesus answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on the pinnacle of the temple and says unto him, if thou be the Son of God, that's the bone of contention. I've lost the position, the high position as the morning star, as a Lucifer, as the head of all the angels of God, and the honor has not come to you. And you are the only one being uplifted, being exalted, being glorified, and being honored. And I'm hearing that the Father testified from heaven, you are the Son of God. If you are the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written. And you know, if you want to confront the devil, you need to really get ready. When the first one he said, make this stone to become bread, he never quoted the Bible. But when Jesus responded and he quoted the Bible, the devil said, I know the Bible too, and I'm going to get through to you what you know. You know, temptations can come in any way. In any way, if you have a particular good quality, if you have a particular, peculiar quality, that good quality can be used of the devil to bring temptation your way. And because Jesus Christ, the Word personified, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and full of glory. You know, if you know the Word of God, the devil is going to come through that Word of God. The devil is going to use that weapon of your talent, of your gift, of your ability to bring temptation to you. And so he said, it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee. In their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, it is written again. You know what the devil wanted to do? He wanted to stop Jesus from saying, it is written. It is written. Okay, I'll copy what it says. I'll repeat what it says. You know what the devil wants to do? If you have a particular gift the Lord has given you, he may abuse that gift. He may prostitute that gift. He may make fun of that gift. He can repeat that thing. You have it, I have it too. Don't stop saying it is written just because the devil said it is written. And don't shut up on the word of God just because the devil is using your own sword. And the devil says, you want to destroy me by that sword of the word it is written? I will use that same word sword against you. It is written. And so Jesus said, it is written again. We're not going to stop quoting the word. We're not going to stop standing on the word. We're not going to deny the word. It is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Then in verse 8, again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and says unto him, all these things I will give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. He stopped using the word it is written now, because he saw you cannot quote the word more than Jesus, the word personified. You cannot distort the word, twist the word, abuse and insult him with the word, and stop him because of that. When Jesus said, it is written again, then the devil packed that aside. That's not his area. It's not a specialty in that. It just tried to use that to make Jesus Christ stop using the word. And then he says unto him, all these things I will give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. That's what he's looking for. He's looking for worship. He's looking for honor. He's looking for praise. The devil will do everything by himself and through his demons and through his angels to make you stop worshiping God and be worshiping him. To make you stop looking unto Jesus and looking unto him. To make you stop giving reverence and honor and glory and worship and adoration to the Almighty God. And make you to start giving him that glory, that honor, that worship, that adoration, that praise and that gratitude. And so he said, fall down and worship me and I'll give you something. Be very careful of the promise of the devil. Be very careful of what the devil is coming to you and telling you, if you do this, if you serve me, I'm going to promote you. Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written. If you are a man of the word, a woman of the word, a boy, a girl of the word, you're going to be victorious. You're going to overcome. Because it is that word that lives in you, that gives you the strength and the power and the ability and the authority to be able to whip the devil every time and to overcome the devil every time. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, the devil will leave you. I said the devil will leave you. You know, when the devil has a purpose, he wants to make you fall. He wants to make you deny the Lord. He wants to make you backslide. He wants to make you sin. He wants to make you yield to temptation. And you keep on standing. And you are steadfast in your faith with purpose of mind. And you are steadfast in your faith with determination that you will not look back and you will not fall. Eventually, it will be tired before you get tired. I said the devil will be tired before you get tired. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. And that's what the Lord is leading us to in the message that we're giving today, that as Jesus overcame the devil and he overcame every temptation, you too, you will overcome in Jesus' name. How are you going to overcome? In Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 13. In Romans chapter 6, verse 13, neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin. Don't yield to sin. Don't yield to the devil. Don't yield to the tempter. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. You yield yourself to the Lord. You submit yourselves to the Lord. That means to the word of God. That means to the will of God. That means to the way of the Lord. That means to the wisdom of God. And you're searching every time. I'm not going to yield myself to the devil. I'm not going to yield myself to sin. I'm not going to yield myself to selfish ambition. I'm not going to yield myself to the suggestions of the world. I want to yield myself completely and willingly, unquestionably, totally, entirely unto the Lord. And when that's the purpose of your mind, when that is the decision of your heart, you will overcome. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 57. It says, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, because he won the victory himself. Because of that, he lives in us, he lives with us, and he's supporting us and helping us and lifting us up. And every time we look up to Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith, he gives us the victory. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. As you look at this verse, you understand what kind of victory you have. Complete victory. Total victory. Victory every time, and victory everywhere, and victory over every temptation, because it says he always causes us to triumph. Always. Every time. Satan comes from any direction. Even some directions you didn't know the devil will come from. If you will trust the Lord and depend upon the Lord, it says that God always causes us to triumph in Christ. As long as you abide in Christ and you remain in Christ and Christ remains in you, he makes you to triumph every time and make us manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. I'm speaking to you today, teaching you the word of God on the subject power for victory over temptation. Temptations will come. The tempters will not spare you. And the devil, the master tempter, will not spare you either. Temptations will come. But there is power for victory over temptation and over the tempter. I divide the message to three parts. Number one, the secret of Christ's victory over temptation. The secret of Christ's victory over temptation. Number two, the source of the Christian's victory over temptation. If the Christian is going to be triumphant, if he's going to be victorious, more than a conqueror, what's the source of his strength? What's the source of his power? What's the source of his victory? The source of the Christian's victory over temptation. Number three, the strength of conquerors and victors over the tempter. The strength of conquerors and victors over the tempter. I come to point number one. The secret of Christ's victory over temptation. As we look at the Lord Jesus Christ and the very fact that he overcame temptation and overcame temptation every time, no matter what direction the devil was coming from, as we look at the victory of the Lord Jesus Christ, what's his secret? Because when we discover a secret, we who are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ will be able to maintain the victory too over the tempter, over the devil, over Satan, and over the agents of Satan. And let's come back to the account of the temptation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're looking at it from Luke chapter 4. In Luke chapter 4, reading from verse 1. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. You see the first scene here, that Jesus Christ was full of the Holy Ghost. And let me just run down to verse 14. I'll come back to verse 2. In verse 14 it says, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee. At the beginning, before the temptation, he was full of the Holy Ghost. And then the devil threw all the darts and all the arrows and all the temptation and all the pointed poison spears at him. And yet Jesus Christ had a shield by which he deflected all those arrows and all those spears, pointed and poison piercing arrows of the devil. And at the end of it, the Spirit of God did not decrease in him. What's the evidence of victory in temptation? That the power you had before the temptation, after the temptation, the power is still there. That the love you had before the temptation, after the temptation, the love is still there. And the conviction you had before the temptation, after the temptation, the conviction is still there. The courage you had before the temptation, after the temptation, the courage is still there. What's the evidence of the victory of the Lord Jesus Christ? Here is the evidence that at the beginning, before the temptation, he was full of the Holy Ghost. And when the temptations came, and the temptations came, and the temptations came, he overcame and overcame and overcame. At the end of all the temptations, the power and the fullness of the Holy Spirit was still there. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee. Now come back to verse 2, being 40 days tempted of the devil. And in those days, he did eat nothing. And when they were ended, he was afterward and hungered. And the devil said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. You see that little word, if? That's the method the devil always uses, if. And it supplant doubt in your heart. Are you a child of God? Okay, if you're a child of God, do this. And if the Lord has saved you, if you are born again, your sins are forgiven. And the witness of the Spirit of God is in your heart, you are a child of God. You are a new creature in Christ. The devil is going to try to erode into the assurance of salvation in your heart. And is going to say, if you are a child of God, you've heard about sanctification and you prayed. And you desired, and you consecrated, and you laid everything upon the altar, and you're sanctified. The devil is going to try and plant a kind of doubt in your heart if you are truly sanctified. If anybody can ever be sanctified, if sanctification is actually a Bible doctrine, this, and this, is going to suggest something. And then the power of the Holy Ghost, after you are saved and you are sanctified and you are filled with the Holy Ghost, the devil is going to bring doubt in your heart if you are actually filled with the Holy Ghost. He's going to use that word, if. You have prayed and God has healed you. And the devil is going to bring an if you are truly healed. Why don't you carry this heavy thing? Now, he's going to plant doubt because he wants you to doubt God. That's always his method. That's always his strategy. If you are the Son of God, command these stone that they be made bread. You see the trick there? If you do it, you are obeying the devil. And the devil has won. And the devil becomes your master. Because he who gives the command is the master. He who obeys that command is a servant. So if Jesus said, I'll prove it to you, I can do it, I'm the Son of God, and then he turns the stone into bread, it'll be obeying the devil. Obeying the devil of me is not obeying the Father. If he did not do it, then the devil will laugh and say, hey, there you are. You are not a son of God. You are not the son of God because I just told you. Now prove it to me. If you are the son of God, command that the stone be made bread. You cannot do it. You are not the son of God. Go this way or go that way. The devil is trying to get you whatever direction you go. But look at Jesus, and Jesus answered saying, it is written. It's not a matter whether I can do it or I cannot do it. Whether I'm going to do it or I'm not going to do it, but it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil taketh him up into an high mountain and showed him unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power, all this authority, all this possession will I give thee. And the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will, I give it. If thou wilt therefore worship me, all shall be thine. And you know that the scripture has prophesied and predicted that Jesus will be king, that Jesus will reign, and that his kingdom will not have any end. He'll have dominion from sea to sea. But he will go to the cross. The way of the cross leads home. The way of the cross leads home. It is good to know as I onward go that the way of the cross leads home. But the devil was trying to say, why are you going to go through the cross? Why are you going to die on the cross? Why are you going to bear the pain? Why are you going to go through all that difficulty when I can give everything to you easy here? Because everything has been delivered to me. If you just fall down and worship me between us here, privately here, I'll give everything to you. The devil is going to try to tell you something. He's going to try to tell you, avoid pain. Avoid persecution. There is another way to have this thing you are looking for, the blessing and the glory and the honor and the riches and the job and the child and the wife or the husband or the success, academic success. There is another way for you to have it, and it is not that difficult. And it's going to be the way of compromise and the way of sin and the way of worshiping the devil. But if you are a person that understands what has been prophesied, the Lord will make you the head and not the tail. Not through the devil's method. The Lord will make you to succeed in everything you do, not through the devil's method. The Lord will give you the desires of your heart, not through the devil's method. If you know the promise of God, and you know what lies ahead, you are not going to yield to the devil. Jesus knew without going through the way of the devil, he was still going to reign. That's why he did not yield to the devil, and Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan. For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, him only shalt thou serve. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. You see that? And the devil is going to bring a temptation to a Pentecostal church like ours. You see the other Pentecostal churches, you see what they're doing? They're demonstrating power. They're doing this, they're doing this. If you too, if you are Pentecostal, and if you have the fullness of the power of the Holy Ghost, look at the wonders they're doing there. Do it too. It's alright to work miracles when we're led by the Lord. When we're led by compassion for the needs of the people. But if it is by comparison, if it is by competition, if it is by, they're doing it in the other place, And they're doing that in the other place. And they're doing that in the other place. If you are as Pentecostal as they are, if you are as charismatic as they are, if you are as powerful as they are, do it too and demonstrate it. Let us see. That's the wrong motive. That's the wrong reason. And if you yield to that church, if you yield to that coordinators and preachers and overseers, you're yielding to the suggestion of the devil. And it's a temptation from the devil. And so Jesus Christ said, look at this, for it is written. And so said in verse 12, and Jesus said unto him, it is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, wonderful, temptation will not continue for eternity. Trials will not continue for eternity. And the pain and the pressure we bear will not continue for all eternity. Because the devil, he will get tired. I said he will get tired. But Jesus in you will never be tired. And God in you will never be tired. And the Holy Spirit will never be tired. Just keep on holding on. Keep on holding on. The temptations will soon come to an end. When the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. For a season means I'm still coming back. But devil, only 3.5 years, then you cannot come back to Jesus anymore. But what's the secret of Christ's victory? How did he overcome? Let me show you the secret. One secret is that he knew the word of God. He accepted the word of God. And he knew that the word of God is preeminent. Number one then is the preeminence of the word of God. The preeminence of the word of God. Be a man, a woman of the Bible. A boy, a girl of the Bible. A Christian of the Bible. You are reading the word. You are studying the word. You are memorizing the word. You believe the word. And the sword of the Spirit is strong and mighty in your hand. Because you are a man of the word. And you exalt the word of God. The preeminence of the word. That's why you overcame in John chapter 14 verse 13. John chapter 14 verse 30. Hereafter, I will not talk much with you. For the prince of this world cometh and has nothing in me. And that's another thing. You need to understand that the Lord Jesus Christ had purity of heart. Purity of heart. There was no magnet in Christ to attract Satan. To attract sin. You see, if there is a magnet somewhere, and then there are iron nails or whatever pieces of iron around, that you'll find that the magnet will attract the iron. And if you're not pure in the heart, if there's something wrong in the heart, if there's a wrong motive in the heart, if there is sin in the heart, if there's a selfish desire in the heart, that selfish desire in the heart will attract the temptations of the devil, and the temptation will overcome you. The reason why Jesus Christ overcame, the secret of Christ's victory over temptation is that Satan had nothing in him to attract the temptation of the devil. In John chapter 8, John chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 29. It says, and he that sent me is with me. The Father has not let me alone, for I do always those things that please him. I do always those things that please him, and the Father is always with me. Now, what's the secret of the victory of Jesus? The presence of God with him every time. The presence of God with him every time. When you set the Lord before you all the time, and you're looking at the Lord, at Jehovah God, the Jehovah God of heaven. And it's always before you. His strength is your strength. His power is transferred into your life. That presence of God will give you the victory every time. In John chapter 14, verses 9, verses 11, and 10 and 11. John chapter 14, verse 10. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me. Or else believe me for the very work's sake, and you will see the Lord Jesus Christ here, the presence of the Father. He was conscious of that every time. I mean, the Father, and the Father is in me. And then in John chapter 4, verse 34, John chapter 4, verse 34, it says, Jesus says unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to finish his work. My meat is to do the work of him that sent me, and to finish his work. When you have purpose of life, and you are focused on the glory of God, on the will of God, it will be difficult for the devil to get you. He will try. He will run around. He will tempt. He will harass you. He'll put pressure on you. He'll try to cause you some problems so that you'll change. But if you have a purpose of life, and you are focused on the glory of God and the will of God, you will overcome. That's why Jesus overcame. That's how Jesus overcame, because he had that purpose of his life. To do the will of God, to remain in the will of God, until the will of God was fully and completely accomplished. It tells us in John chapter 6, verse 38. John 6, verse 38. For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. He said, that's why I came. And this is the reason I'm here. I'm not to do my own will. When the devil said, turn these stones to become bread, that will be a pleasure for me. That will satisfy me. That will feed me. That will help me. Well, I'm not here for myself. I'm going to check off from the Father. Is that the will of the Father? Is that the desire of the Father? Is that the command of the Father? Is that what the Father desires for me to do at this time? Because I'm here to please the Father. I came from heaven not to do my own will. Not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. Do you see that? You need to have this kind of focus on God's will. And you need to have this purpose in your life, like the Lord Jesus Christ, because it is a purpose that will give you the kind of victory that the Lord Jesus Christ had. And if you look at Hebrews chapter 1, Hebrews chapter 1, reading from verse 9, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 9, thou hast loved righteousness and hast hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, has anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. If you're going to be an overcomer, overcoming temptation, overcoming trial, overcoming pressures, overcoming the pain, overcoming the enticement of the devil to succumb, to yield, to compromise, if you're going to overcome, you will love righteousness. You will love purity. And you will hate unrighteousness. You will hate iniquity. Even the appearance of evil, you will hate it. You will say, no, that cannot be. I cannot do that because I hate the appearance of evil. I hate everything that resembles evil, resembles iniquity. Because he loved righteousness and he hated iniquity. That's the reason he was able to overcome every time temptation came to him. In 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. That's why we're studying the victory of Christ. That's why we're studying the triumph of Christ. That's why we're studying the conquest of Christ, that he overcame, so that you too, you'll overcome. He left us an example that we should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who when he was reviled, he reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but he committed himself unto him that judgeth righteously. He wouldn't fight for himself. He wouldn't defend himself. I'm here because of God. I'm here because of his glory. I'm here because of his honor. I'm here because of the Lord God in heaven. And then he committed himself to the Almighty God that judges righteously. We're looking at Luke chapter 24. In Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 44. Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 44. In Luke 24 verse 44, here it says, and he said unto them these words, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. He said, I told you, I've been looking at the word and have the perception of what is written concerning me. And when you have perception of what is written concerning you, it will be difficult for the devil to get you. You already know, well, this is what God has for me, and this is the way the Lord has appointed for me, and this is the route I am going to take, because that is what is written concerning me. When you have the proper perception of what is written for you, there will be no problem at all. You'll be able to live a victorious life, and you'll overcome temptation. Of course, you understand, when he knew what was written concerning him, he knew the future glory. The future glory. And he knew that this period of time was just time of preparation for the future glory. That's the secret of the victory of the Lord Jesus Christ over temptation. Let me summarize for you that point one. Number one, the presence of God. The presence of God was always with him. And because the presence of God was always with him, no problem at all, he always overcame. Number two, the power of the Spirit. He had the power of the Spirit in him. And the Spirit that dwelt in him was not a spirit of fear, a spirit of timidity, a spirit of compromise, a spirit of cringing. It was a spirit that gave him courage and boldness and victory over the devil. Number three, the preeminence of the word. Preeminence of the word. Because the word of God was preeminent in him, that's how he overcame. Number four, the purity of heart. I told you, because there was no magnet in him to magnetize or to attract the things of the devil. Because of that purity of heart, he overcame. Number five, the purpose of his life. He was sold on the glory of God. He was dedicated to the glory of God. He was committed to the glory of God. He was focused on the glory of God. And because of that purpose of heart, that's why he overcame. Number six, the perception of what is written concerning him. He knew. If the devil came to tempt, that had been written concerning me. And if the word of God is in my mouth, that's written concerning me. The word I put in your mouth will never depart from your mouth. And through that word, you'll have the victory. He opened my ear every morning, and he puts in the word of God, and he speaks at the mouthpiece of the Lord. Perception of what is written concerning him. Number seven, preparation for future glory. If you know what you are preparing for, the future glory, and you know the Lord will soon come and take you to himself, that preparation for future glory will keep you victorious every time, will keep you on the victory side, triumphant over the devil, over the works of the devil every time. I go to point number two, the source of the Christian's victory over temptation. The source of the Christian's victory over temptation. How does a Christian win the victory? How does a Christian have the victory? Here we are. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, reading from verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them, God was not well pleased. Here Paul the Apostle said that you are born again doesn't mean that you are going to be victorious every time if you don't know the source of your victory. that you are born again doesn't mean that you remain saved, steadfast, standing until the end if you don't know the source of the Christian's victory. It says, I don't want you to be ignorant. I want to remind you. Do you remember those millions of the Israelites that came out of Egypt? That's a picture of our redemption. That's a picture of our salvation. They came out of Egypt like we have come out of the world. And they were brought unto the Father, unto God, like we are brought unto God, reconciled unto God through the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, they were baptized unto Moses, like you are baptized unto Jesus, in the authority of the name of Jesus. They were baptized in water. And he did all eat the same spiritual meat, as you have been hearing the word of God, and you have been drinking the milk of the word, and chewing the meat of the word. And he did all drink the same spiritual drink, and he drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. And so, whatever experience you have, whatever privilege you have, whatever opportunities you have, remember that the children of Israel had the same privilege, but with many of them, God was not well pleased. What happened to them? It says in verse 5, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now, these things were written, were our examples to the intent. We should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted. You see, there are people that will teach that there is eternal security. That once you are saved, you don't need to worry about whether you are going to stand or you are not going to stand. That you are saved, and you are saved forever. That you cannot lose your salvation, and you cannot miss heaven, because already you are born again is a deception of the devil. The devil likes that doctrine. Because when the devil comes to people that believe eternal security, the devil knows that they will not resist the temptation. They will not try to overcome the temptation. Because the devil will tell them, even if you obey me, you'll still get to heaven. Even if you commit sin, you'll still get to heaven. Even if you yield to my temptation, you'll still get to heaven. What's the problem with you? Don't you know there's eternal security? And whatever I tell you to do, if I tell you to steal, and you steal. If I tell you to fight, and you fight. If I tell you to get hungry, and you get angry. If I get you to commit adultery, and you commit adultery, after all, what does it matter? You will get to heaven at last. The devil likes that doctrine of eternal security. But the Apostle Paul was warning them. He was telling them, you must overcome. You need to understand. You need to keep the victory. If you're going to reign with the Lord eventually now, these things were our examples to the intent. We shall not lust after evil things as they also lusted. Neither be ye idolaters as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and to drink, and they rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication. Neither let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 23,000. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and were destroyed of the serpents. You see, there were people that committed presumptuous sins. Before the sin came, they knew it was sin. They knew it was not all right. But they said, I will still do it anyway. I will still act that way anyway. We know it's not right. We know it's not okay. The Spirit of God bearing witness in their hearts. Are you not a child of God? Or are you going to walk that direction? Or are you going to go to that place? That thing you want to say, you know it's a lie, don't you? You know that's a lie. How will you open your mouth and say that thing deliberately? And they still went ahead and said what they knew to be wrong, what they knew to be a lie, what they knew to be deception. They were tempting Christ, they were tempting the Lord. And here Paul the Apostle was saying, neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted, and they were destroyed of serpents. Neither murmur ye. Was a terrible sin. If the devil cannot get a Christian through adultery, through fornication, if the devil cannot get a Christian to fall and to yield to temptation through stealing, if the devil cannot get a Christian to drink and to smoke, if the devil cannot get a Christian through, walking through 419, he'll get them by murmuring. He'll get them by complaining. He'll get them by grumbling. They will murmur against God, against the word of God, against the people of God, against the leadership in the church, against their husbands, against their wives, against sectional leaders in the church. They'll find something to murmur about. When the devil is behind somebody and is pushing him and pushing him and pushing him, you will not steal, you will not commit adultery, you will not smoke, you will not drink, and you will not fight. I'll get you to follow all the same. And many people, when they murmur like that, they don't know they're yielding to the temptation of the devil. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured, and they were destroyed of the destroyer. Now, all these things happen unto them. For examples, and they are reaching for our admonition upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. Let the people that are overconfident, let them take heed. Let the people that say, I can never fall, I know myself, I'm strong, I'm mighty, I'm powerful, take heed, lest you fall. Let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. And he's talking about temptation. There is no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Wherefore, my beloved, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. You don't say, well, idolatry, really, I'm beyond that now. I've grown beyond that. I can overcome that any day. I'm stronger than that. Flee and run away from idol worship. In James chapter 4, I'm reading from verses 6 and 7. We're looking at the source of victory for the Christian. The Christian that wants to keep on standing. And a Christian that wants to remain victorious until Christ comes. The source of that Christian's victory over temptation. James chapter 4 verse 6. But he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. The people that say, Lord, I'm not strong by myself. The people that say, without Christ, I can do nothing, I am nothing. The people that say, I'm not overconfident, I'm not even confident at all in myself. What do I know? What do I have? What can I do? You must help me. He giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The assurance we're given is, if we will resist the devil, in the strength of the Lord, in the power of the Lord, by the anointing of the Spirit of God, and by the conviction, the courage, the boldness the Lord has given us. It says, if we resist the devil, he will flee from us. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through 9, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. And then he says, be sober, don't be frivolous, don't be careless, don't let the devil catch you being frivolous, don't let the devil catch you belittling the word of God, belittling the spiritual things, don't let the devil catch you being unserious and careless and carefree. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a running lion, the devil who wants to catch the Christian is not frivolous. He's watchful. He's looking at you for your careless moment. He's not carefree. He's very serious. And he means business. And if you don't mean business, to really stand firm in the Lord, knowing there is a crown waiting for you, knowing that Christ is coming, and you need to endure to the end if you are going to be saved. If you are not as serious as the devil, and the devil is so serious running after you, wanting to make you fall, if you forget yourself, if you are carefree, and if you are frivolous, he'll catch you. Be sober. Be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith. Resist him persistently. resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. And then you need the word of God. We're told in Psalm 119, reading from verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. Are we going to remain clean, remain righteous, remain pure, remain victorious, remain more than a conqueror? By taking heed according to thy word. A real Christian who understands that it's important to have victory over temptation will not play for the word of God. He'll read that word. He will study that word. And you'll underline salient, important passages that strike you in the word of God. You will eat of that bread of life, of that word of God. You will sharpen the sword of the Spirit, the word of God in your life. If you want to have the victory, because that's how you can cleanse your way. That's how you can remain clean, remain victorious, by taking heed according to thy word. With my whole heart have I sought thee. Oh, let me not wander from thy commandments. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Don't hide other things in your heart. You understand? If you fill your box with useless, worthless, unimportant things, there will be no space for real things of importance in that box anymore. And if you fill the bucket with something worthless, useless, unimportant, you'll not have space in that bucket for something that is very useful and very necessary. When you fill your heart with unnecessary things, things of this life and the cares of this life, there'll be no space in that place for the word of God. And it is the word of God that gives you the victory every time. Your word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. That's how to have the victory. Of course, you must be a man of decision, a man of determination, a man of passion, a man of purpose, that you are not going to sin, you are not going to yield to the devil. In Daniel chapter 1, Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat. You need that purpose, because that meat will come, the dainty meat of Babylon, and the desires of the people of the world, and the pressures and the pleasures of the people of the world. Of course it will come. But you make a purpose in your heart, determination, decision within you. You will not defile yourself. Except that purpose of heart is there, you will be defiled. Because the thing will be so attractive, and the thing will be so inviting, and the thing will be so pleasing to the flesh, and then it will be so popular. Many other people are doing it. Why don't you? Many other people are yielding. Why don't you yield? You must have a purpose in your heart if you're going to overcome the devil. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 9. Here the word of God is reminding us, they that will be rich fall into temptation and snare. The people who want money at all costs, they must have it. They must be rich. Quick. Even as teenagers, even as young people, we must have the money now. Education, not important. Training, not important. And having wisdom in life, that's not important. We need money now. And the men and the women that are just committed to looking for money, if they go anywhere, if they come to church, if they read the Bible, all they're looking for is promises on money. And they're not thinking of holiness, righteousness, sanctification. Everything is money. You're going to fall into temptation, because the money will so blindfold you, you will not know how to escape temptation. It says, but they that will be rich fall into temptation is near, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil. The love of money is the root of all evil. Even in the church, If there is a love of money, it will be the root of all evil. You're told to go and buy something for the church, and you'll be looking for you're going to cheat the church because the love of money is there. And you're backsliding long, long ago without recovering yourself. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, man of God, child of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. And we're told in Matthew chapter 26, Matthew chapter 26, reading from verses 40 and 41. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 40, and he comments unto his disciples, and findeth them asleep, and says unto Peter, watch, could ye not watch with me an hour, 1 hour? Watch and pray, that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. We need to keep on praying, because it is a prayer that will shield you, that will strengthen you, that will help you and support you to overcome temptation. In 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, reading from verse 12. 1 John chapter 2, verse 12, I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I have written unto you, I write unto you, little children, because ye have known the Father. I have written unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you. And ye have overcome the wicked one. If we're going to be strong to the point to overcome the wicked one, it's as a result of the word of God abiding in us. Once again, let me ask you, what's the source of the Christian's victory over temptation? Number one, the presence of Christ within. I'll never leave you. I'll be with you. So, when the devil comes, realize, be conscious of the presence of Christ within. Number two, the power of the Spirit. The Spirit that dwelt, that raised up Jesus from the dead, it dwells in your mortal body. And because it dwells in you and remains in you, you'll be victorious. Number three, persevering in purity to endure to the end. Every time temptation comes, you understand, you were pure yesterday, but you must continue persevering in purity so that you will endure unto the very end. Number four, prevailing prayer of faith. Watch and pray that you will not fall into temptation. Prevailing prayer of faith. Number five, persistent resistance of temptation. Persistent resistance of temptation. Oh, the devil will still come. You keep on persisting. You keep on resisting. I said no before Satan. I'm still saying no. And the devil said, why don't you do this? You've been, you know, waiting for marrying somebody and you've tried and tried and there is no believer to get married to. Why don't you go and marry an unbeliever? That's a great temptation. And you say, Satan, I said no 2 years ago. I said no last year. I'm still saying no today. My mother suggested it. I said no. And my auntie suggested it. I said no. And some backsliders who have done it and they have lost their victory, they have lost the glory of God in their lives. Some backsliders suggested to me, I said no. And you are saying it, I'm still saying no. That's how to overcome the devil. Persistent resistance of temptation. Then number six, you have the purpose of living. You're seeking for God's glory. You have a purpose in your heart, you have a purpose in your mind, and you're focused on the Lord. You say, that's all I'm living for. That's all I'm living for. The purpose for living. Then number 7, possession of God's grace. You're seeking the grace of God, and you have the grace of God. You possess the grace of God. And the Lord says, my grace is sufficient for you. Possession of God's grace. Number 8 is passion and vision for heaven. You want to get to heaven. You know there is heaven. You know Jesus has gone to prepare a place for you. And you know if you are going to be in heaven, everyone that has their soap in him purifies himself, even as he is pure, because of that passion and vision for heaven. That's why you will not yield to temptation. Number 9, proclamation and pursuit of Christ's victory. You are proclaiming the victory of Christ. And you are saying, because he triumphed, I will triumph too. Because he overcame, I will overcome too. You are proclaiming and you are pursuing the victory of Christ. Number 10, the promise of divine support and help. The promise of divine support and help. You are relying upon the promise of God. And it says, I'll support you. You will not fall. I will keep you. I will hold you in my hand. I will not allow you to fall. And you are depending upon that promise of divine support and divine help. I come to point number 3. The strength of conquerors and victors over the tempter. The strength of conquerors and victors over the tempter. In Hebrews chapter 2, I'm reading verse 18. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor, is able to sustain, is able to support, is able to hold up them that are tempted. Because Christ has overcome. In all his temptations, he was a victor. Because he overcame, you too, you can overcome. That's why you go to the Lord in prayer. That's why you are serious and you are telling the Lord, Lord, help me, sustain me, support me, and hold me up, hold my hand so that I will not fall. Hebrews chapter 4 from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 4 from verse 14. See then, that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but he was in all points tempted like us we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let's come boldly to the throne of grace. That's the reason when, after you've had the word of God, and you come to pray, you pray with all your heart, with all your soul. Because you don't want to appear like, mocking God. And you don't want to appear like little children. I mean, real infants who do not know the essence of prayer. And they do not know the reason for prayer. And they do not know the power we derive in prayer. They do not know the need we have of prayer. And therefore, when their parents tell them to pray, you know what they do at home, those little infants. But those of us, teenagers, those of us, men and women that know God, that know that we need strength from the Lord, we come to the throne of grace because we need help. Temptation will come today. Temptation will come during the week. Temptation will come in our lives. We need the strength of the Lord. We need the grace of the Lord. Therefore, we come with all seriousness. And we come with all heavy heart. And with a disposition that is telling the Lord, I cannot bear this load alone. I cannot overcome this temptation alone. I cannot live this life alone. Help me. That's how the Lord will help. Isaiah chapter 40. In Isaiah chapter 40, reading from verse 28, hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint. If your temptations are so much, and your temptations are almost overwhelming you, and you're almost fainting, almost falling, almost yielding, almost succumbing and surrendering to the devil, he giveth power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. You know, the youths and the young men that are thinking, oh, we're strong. There's nothing. Oh, all those people bring in the temptation. Are they not teenagers like myself, young people like myself? I can overcome. They are surprised when the temptations eventually come and they fall. And that's why the encouragement is coming to boys, girls, teenagers, adults, men, women, all believers. Wait on the Lord. Verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I pray the Lord will give us the spirit of supplication, the spirit of prayer. And we will overcome in Jesus' name. In Joshua chapter 1, reading from verse 6. Be strong and of a good courage. You are going to overcome the devil. Be strong and of a good courage. Don't let the devil see fearfulness, timidity, and trembling and shaking in you. If the devil sees that you are afraid of him, you are afraid of evil spirits, and you are afraid of witches and wizards, and you are afraid of girls and women and tempters and temptresses, if the devil sees that you are not sure of the grace of God in you, you are not sure of the strength and the might of the Spirit of the living God, and you are always quaking, always trembling, always, timid, and the devil is going to take advantage of that. Be strong and of a good courage, for unto these people shall thou divide for an inheritance the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law, which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left. Be committed to the word of God. Don't turn to the left. Don't turn to the right. Don't look for any easy way. Just stay with the word of God, abide with the word of God every time. And then it says that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. Don't meditate on what the worldly people are saying, what the backsliders are teaching, what the backsliders are suggesting. Don't meditate on what the tempters are saying. Meditate on the word of God. The book of the law of God shall not depart from your mouth. You'll meditate on it day and night. Why? So that you'll observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then shalt thou make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success. In Isaiah chapter 52. Isaiah chapter 52. I read from verse 1, verse 2, and then verse 11. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 1. Awake, awake. Put on thy strength, O Zion. The word of God as your strength. The armor of the Lord as your strength. Put on your strength, people of God. And then it says, your beautiful garment, the garment of salvation, and the garments of praise. Put on your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem. For henceforth, there shall no more come into thee the uncircumcised and the unclean. Shake thyself from the dust. Have you fallen already? Rise up. As the devil puts your nose, your mouth to the ground to lick the dust, shake yourself from the dust and say, my enemy rejoice not against me. When I fall, I shall rise again. As he made you a backslider, and now you are in the far country, and you are in the midst of swines and sows and pigs, trying to eat what the people of the world are eating and drinking what the people of the world are drinking. Arise and shake yourself from the doors, and see thou, Jerusalem, loose thyself from the bands of thy neck. If the devil has put a single rope around your neck, and you are still sitting down there, he's going to make another turn, another round, another chain. If the devil has defeated you, and you are lying down there, is going to bring a heavy chain and tie you down there until the day of resurrection, until the day of the rapture, tie you down there that will not allow you to rise. And before he does that and manifests greater power in your life to keep you down, rise up. and say, no, I will not remain a backslider. I'm going to serve the Lord. Temptations no more. Sin no more. Yielding to the devil no more. I'm going to be cleansed in the blood of the Lamb. Shake yourself from the doors. Arise and sit down and loose thyself from the bands of thy neck, O captive daughter of Zion. And in verse 11, depart ye, depart ye. Come out of that place. And the prostitutes are ganging up around you. And the gangs of robbers are trying to make you to be in their company. Come out of there and touch no unclean thing. Go ye out of the midst of her and be clean, ye that bear the vessels of the Lord. And say, you will have the victory, and you'll have the victory in Jesus' name. The Lord is calling you today. If you are backsliding, you have yielded to temptation, and the Lord is saying, you can repent. And you can turn to the Lord. You can shake yourself from the doors. You can arise. And all those evil things that you have gone into, you can turn away from them. All the gangs you have joined. All the society you have joined. All the people, unserious people, devilish people, backsliding people, sinful people. And the people that are not going to heaven. And they are inviting, and you have joined them. It says, come out from the midst of them. And be separate, says the Lord. And then I will receive you. I will take you unto myself. I'll be your father. You'll be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And as you come, and the Lord forgives you, don't just stay there. Keep on moving on and have greater Christian experiences in your life. When you are saved, don't stay there. Get sanctified. When you are sanctified, don't stay there. Get filled with the Holy Ghost. When you get filled with the Holy Ghost, don't stay there. Be involved in the service of the Lord and be winning souls and yield yourself fully to the Lord. In Ephesians chapter 6, reading from verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. You can't be weak in the Lord. If you are in the Lord, you'll not be weak. If you are in the Lord, you'll not be timid. If you are in the Lord, you'll not be fearful. If you are in the Lord, you'll not be shaking for the devil. If you are in the Lord, you'll be strong in the Lord. If you are in the Lord already, come on and come nearer to the Lord. Come closer to the Lord. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. And don't just say, well, I put on this one, I put on that one. That's enough. No, it's not enough. It's not enough. Keep on moving on. Keep on moving on. And it says, you'll put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Thank God we can stand. I said, thank God we can stand. When the devil comes like a roaring lion, when he comes like a mighty flood, and he wants to overwhelm you, you have the faith in God, you have the understanding in God, you have the conviction in God. We, the people of God, we can stand, and we will stand in Jesus' name. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. The day of temptation, that's the evil day. The day when the devil is soliciting that you fall into temptation, that you go back to your vomit and take up your vomit again, that's the evil day. But when you rise now, and when you shake yourself from the doors, and you call upon the name of the Lord, and now you put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand and withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore. Having your loins girt about with truth. Having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, beyond all, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench. How many darts of the devil? How many? We can have victory, no matter from what direction the devil is coming. No matter the darts, the fairy darts, and the arrows that the devil might be throwing. No matter the method and the strategy, and the wiles of the devil, and the temptation. We can quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always. Praying always. Serious prayer. Praying always, fervent prayer. praying always heartfelt prayer, praying always sincere prayer, praying always prayer of faith, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto, and with all perseverance and supplication with all saints. That's how we're going to have the victory. You will not allow the devil to touch you. And he will not touch you. You will not allow the devil to bring you down. He will not bring you down. In 1 John chapter 5 verse 18. 1 John chapter 5 verse 18. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. When you are born of God, the grace is there not to sin. The power is there not to sin. The virtue of Christ is there not to sin. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself. You will keep yourself. You cannot be running around with backsliders and think you are going to stay. You are going to stand firm. You cannot be running around with hypocrites and think that you are going to go free. You cannot be running around with people that do not take the word of God serious and think that you're going to get to heaven. He keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. And then in verse 21, little children, keep yourselves from idols. You will keep yourselves. That's how the Lord is going to keep you. You show the seriousness that you actually want to stand. You want to be kept in the Lord and kept in the faith. That's how you stand. In Jude, reading from verse 20. Jude, verse 20. But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourselves. Boys, keep yourselves. Girls, keep yourselves. Fathers and mothers, keep yourselves. If you are born again, if you are a child of God, and you have the desire to get to heaven, keep yourselves. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And of some, have compassion, making a difference in your evangelism. You're going out, you're evangelizing. That's all right. Have compassion on them. But others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire. There are some sinners that already they are at the brink of hell. And some of those sinners do not care whether they go to hell or don't go to hell. And they want to pull. Now, even the believers that are trying to evangelize them, be wise. I'm a wise as serpents and gentle, harmless as doves. It says others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Now, unto him that is able to keep you from falling, God is able. I said God is able. Whatever temptations may face your life, and whatever challenges you may face, whatever trials may be there, unto him that is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. And everybody said, amen. The Lord will keep you. The Lord understands what you are going through. He has enough grace for you. Grace for salvation. Grace for sanctification. Grace for your trials. And grace for every need of your life. Let's now go boldly before the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find help in the time of need. I pray that all of us who have heard this word today, the salvation of the Lord will not miss us in Jesus' name. And then the strength of the Lord to stand firm and stand faithful and stand true unto the end. The Lord will make us stand in Jesus' name. Pray to the Lord before you go. And tell the Lord, oh Lord, here am I. I want to be an overcomer. I want to overcome temptation every time. I know the grace is there. I know the promise is there. I know the power is there. I know the preservation is there. I know the strength of the Lord is there. And I know that you have promised to keep me, and you will keep me, and I want to be kept. And I know your presence will go with me. He is Emmanuel, God with us. He will be with you. If you are not born again, give your life to the Lord and be born again. If you are not a child of God yet, why don't you repent of your sin. Turn away from your sin and say, Lord, here I come. I am a sinner. I know that Jesus died for me on the cross of Calvary. I believe. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And the Lord will save you. And if you have been saved, you need the strength of the Lord. And you need purpose of heart. That you are focused on the glory of God alone. You need that purpose of heart so that the Lord himself will know that you really want the Lord and you desire the Lord. Pray, if you have been saved, that the Lord will give you the victory over sin, victory over temptation, and victory over your trials. And if you have not been sanctified, why don't you get sanctified? Because you see, that Adamic nature within can be an attraction for the devil, a magnet for the devil, that the devil will be coming, and that Adamic nature will not allow you to remain stable and steadfast in the Lord. Why don't you say, Lord, sanctify me? You desire sanctification, you consecrate for sanctification, and you pray for sanctification, and you believe the Lord for sanctification. It says, I'll take the stony heart out of their flesh. I will give them the heart of flesh. Let him do it. Let him do it. Let him take away that Adamic nature. Let him take away that root of sin. Let him take away that propensity to evil. Propensity and tendency to murmuring, to grumbling, to complaining. Let him take everything away and say, Lord, wash me, cleanse me with the blood of the Lamb. Cleanse me, wash me with the blood of the Lamb. Help me to be stable. Help me to be steadfast. I want to serve the Lord. In all sincerity, I want to serve the Lord. Wholeheartedly, I want to serve the Lord. I don't want to be falling and rising. I want to be steadfast and stable in the Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. I cannot overcome by myself alone. I cannot overcome by myself alone. Without me, ye can do nothing. But with Christ, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He will strengthen you. You'll overcome. Put on the strength of God. Put on the armor of God. Put on all the armor of God, that you may be able to stand and withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, don't let the devil get you. Don't let the temptation pull you down. And don't let all these things that are dangling before you in the world, don't let them overwhelm you. You can stand. You can stand. You will stand in the strength of the Lord and the might of the Lord. And remember, whosoever shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. If you yield to temptation and you fall and you don't endure to the end, if Jesus comes and meets you in that falling condition, you'll miss heaven forever. You'll spend eternity in hell. That's why it's important for you to rise now. Arise and shine. Shake off yourself from the dust. And be free from all those evil things that want to overwhelm your life. Put on the strength of the Lord. And don't go back into those evil things anymore. And the Lord will keep you true and keep you faithful, keep you standing, keep you victorious and triumphant until the very end.